name is Yamaya Bourdain. I'm a first year master's student in computer science, and my background is in electrical engineering.
My name is Kamal Sewell, senior, dual degree, engineering and finance. We are Apex Plastics.
Yeah, and I am the CEO of Toshi Optics.
To address a huge unmet opportunity to bring quality control and energy efficiency to the thermoforming and blow molding market. We intend to do so using current quality control technologies already in play, and also we serve to be an online platform for further sustainable technologies that are in development now. We are founded by and advised by industry experts. We have gained meaningful traction in customer development. What are thermoform products? This is a small idea of what they are, but they span the gamut in automotive industry, consumer durables, consumer plastics. To give a rough idea of how big the industry is, last year alone, 5.3 billion pounds of thermoform material were made. It's estimated in 2013, 6.3 billion to be done. To get an idea of the size of the blow molding market, literally every plastic bottle that's made has been blown. The problem, the pain that exists within this industry is that when thermoforming and blow molding manufacturers receive the thermoform material, they are unable to quickly, accurately, and cost-effectively test this material. This results in them having to run the entire process to find these defects, oftentimes resulting in 25 to 45% cost of goods sold being lost. Energy becomes wasted in four main categories. One, for thermoform to actually run the process to find these defects. Two, they have to send it to an independent lab to refute the quality, and they have to resend it to their supplier. The supplier then has to regrind it, then resend it back to the thermoformer. The biggest issue with this is that once they get this new batch, they are still unable to ascertain the quality. They have to go through the same process, and they may still not reach the profit margins that they require. So, a good analogy for this would be, imagine what the diamond industry would be like without the magnifying glass, or the Julius group as it's called. Imagine how hard it would be to test diamonds to make sure that the quality and the purity are correct. That's where we intend to be. We intend to be the jeweler's loop for thermoforming and blow molding industry, integrated at every part of the value chain.
So we intend to do this with the Apex Plastic Prototype 1 Inflation Rheometer. This is a testing instrument that measures the processability of commercial plastics. It's table mounted and computer controlled. We've developed a user-friendly software package that controls its operations. It only uses a small sample, and it takes less than a few minutes in order to run a test. By implementing the AP1 into their system, thermoformers and blow molders will see they'll now be able to control the quality of their raw material. So they'll see improvements in the yield, energy efficiency, and reliability. They'll see reductions in the cost of inspection, as well as waste and rejected materials, and it'll also be provided with optimal process control. The AP1 utilizes the bubble inflation technique in order to measure the thermoformability of these materials. This technique is the best technique because it simulates the same deformation mode that a material sees when it is either thermoformed or blow molded. So that means that we put the material under the same exact conditions when we run the test. By using this technique, we're able to derive the rheological properties of the material, thus being able to predict how the material will behave when it's actually being processed. Here's where we take advantage of our competitive edge. It's only four easy steps in order to run a test on an AP1. When operators run a test, they'll also find that it's similar to the actual process. So therefore, they'll be familiar with the process already. Here's where we really take advantage of our competitive edge. The AP1 gives direct results. There's no data interpretation, and there's minimum training required. When an operator runs a test, they get three numbers. Of those three, two of them are material constants. That means that these are properties that are unique to each material. When we combine these, we get a third, which is a direct relation to the processability of the material. Thus, the thermoformer and a blow mortar are now able to predict exactly how the material will behave when it's being processed. And they can do this all before ever running the actual process.
The world market for thermoforming is $36 billion. Domestically, it is $17 billion. Our total addressable market is $460 million, with an annual growth rate of 3%. We intend to use a combination of market pull and market push strategy, focusing primarily on thermoformers and moving our way up to the thermal sheet suppliers. We have already contacted the top three blow molders and thermoformers within this industry. They are eagerly waiting our product. They heard it, they like the margins, and so on and so forth. We intend to get massive customer traction, because in Thermoforming Quarterly, this issue has been a very, very important topic. As you can see here, it's actually taken up two different issues of Thermoforming Quarterly, the premier journal for the thermoforming industry. Our business model can be customizable, because we've spoken to our top six customers, they have definitely and are definitely aware of the business model and are very appreciative of this model. Our durable piece cost us $5,000 to make, which is our hardware end. We will sell it for $100,000. Our disposable is a combination of maintenance and consulting. Will cost us $216 at $18 an hour. We'll sell it for $50,000. Current thermoforming solutions currently on the market cost between $150,000 to $1 million. This is per run, by request from the thermoforming industry on new tests, and literally all new tests that exist for thermoformers, they actually go directly to him. With regards to legal and accounting situations and hiring of a CEO, Mr. Charles E. Ross, GM for ATDC, incubator locally at Georgia Tech, they have launched in such successful companies as Mindspring, Earthlink, CardioGems. Mr. Alan Urich, from managing partner of Stony River Capital, he has extensive experience in launching startups and primary core experience in our primary market we intend to reach in our business plan, which is the medical industry. Mr. Richard Thaler, I feel a very key part, because he's thoroughly, being that he's former vice chairman of Deutsche Bank's Industrial AG Group, he's very aware of the M&A activity and liquidity in this market so that we can get to an exit in a timely fashion. We are the founders, but we are tentative management until we can find a CEO with the experience to take the company from 0 to $20 million in the desired time.
These are some of the milestones that we intend to achieve within this year. By the third quarter, we intend to incorporate the company, have conducted a detailed market analysis, as well as validated our end customer demand. By the fourth quarter, we, as Kamal said, we would have hired a CEO. We would have built an evaluation model for AP1, as well as conducted AP1 beta testing. Going into the financials, this is our funding timeline. As you can see here, we have already applied for SBIR and STTR funding. We will also source additional funding to the sum of $2.5 million Series A funding through venture capitalists. We plan to be cash flow positive by the second year, and our projected EBITDA by year five will be in excess of $14 million, thus cementing our exit strategy. Speaking of our exit strategy, we are a platform technology, and we are also a technology for other sustainable technologies. For example, phantom consumption, energy efficiency, in addition to we will be able to monitor and capture the carbon emissions for the industry, as well as be a premier brokerage for the carbon credit of the industry.
In summary, we are here to address the huge need to bring quality control and energy efficiency to the thermoforming industry. We feel we have the right team. We feel we have a scalable revenue model. We feel there are high barriers to entry. We feel that this is a real, real pain. And most importantly, we have actually talked to the customers and they are willing and willing for our product. So you as our investors in this market, we are here to make sure that you get your return. And we've done so, and hopefully it's manifested in our presentation and with our founders to manage this execution risk for you so that we can deliver your rate of return on time. Thank you so much.
It's a repetitive manufacturing process. Downtime is important. Right? Mm-hmm. So can you walk me through exactly what happens when you run your test? I mean, what can it compare it to what happens today?
Okay. Yeah. So basically right now in thermoforming, for instance, when they get the raw material, when the thermoformer receives the raw material from the sheet manufacturer, they'll, for instance, they'll clamp the material down, heat it from top to bottom, they'll get a sag. Their format right now is through an inspection. They'll actually tap the material and see what the sag is. What they're actually doing by experience is checking the viscosity to see whether it'll flow. So they run the entire process, and at the end is when they find defects in the material. So then they'll have to ship it up, ship it out, send it back to the sheet supplier. The sheet supplier will take it. I mean, really, the sheet supplier is still making a lot of money, so they'll take it gladly. They'll take it back, and they'll regrind it and ship it back. The same material may not work for instance that application. This may be a thermoformer who thermoforms the jet canopy, so they need a smaller tolerance, but it may be fine for a drinking cup. So sheet supplier can send it straight to them. What will happen here is that the thermoformer will get the material. They'll run a test on the material beforehand. They'll receive the viscosity and the modulus and the thermoformability index number. So they'll receive three numbers. These numbers don't change. Every single time when they get the material, that works. When they get the material, they should get these same three numbers. And that will verify that they have the same exact product. And therefore, any deficiencies that are, because most of the deficiencies are on a molecular scale, any deficiencies that they'll see it when they run this test.
So, can I just follow up for 1 second on this topic, just to drill down?
Yes, sir.
So let's say I'm Impactive, who's on your list, something
yes,
like
sir.
That, right? So they work with a supplier.
Well, actually, they do just point sourcing. They go with the cheapest thermal sheet supplier. They don't.
Okay, they work with a series of suppliers,
right.
Presumably, right? And say for some standard product, bottle, they say, I need, I don't know anything about this industry, so, but I'm guessing they're just saying, I need clear plastic, and I need,
yes.
this thickness, and this, they give them some specific.
Yeah, they specify the color,
yeah.
The thickness,
yeah.
The color and the thickness, one thing, which I can't remember.
But they don't specify these specific characteristics that you guys are testing.
Exactly,
is that correct?
Because they have no way of doing it. Exactly.
Why don't the suppliers test the material when it comes off their lines?
The industry as a whole, as a supplier, it's a volume-based business. They make a lot of their money through sheer volume. So there's really no real incentive for them to give quality to, because they basically,
you don't have any volume.
Say it again?
If you don't give your customers the quality, maybe you don't have.
Well, actually, sir, they actually spot volume, the resin that they get, by the lowest prices your mind was trying to say. And from there, since there's no way to do any quality inspection, a good analogy would be like, imagine the incentive if inspect a diamond. There would be an unbelievable incentive for someone to give you a Cuban zirconia. Why mine in South Africa if you could just create some diamonds in London somewhere, in Antwerp, and just send it? Or better yet, why not create some diamonds off the coast of Florida and just ship them in? It's just a huge incentive.
You can buy those for $10 a carat.
Exactly. There's a huge incentive for them because no one can do quality inspection. For them just to give you whatever, and then when it goes bad, just send it back to us.
Right, and they'll take it, like I said, because they'll take it. The thermal sheet supplier, they've actually gotten so big that they pretty much tell the thermoformers what they want. You know, so since the thermoformers have absolutely no way of actually of testing the quality of getting these numbers, like I said, our competitors, they are rheometer companies. Now, a rheometer is extremely robust. It gives you data. It'll give you, for instance, a coefficient of thermal expansion. It'll give you a viscosity from a range of temperatures. You can take it from 25 to 400. We don't care about that. We care about one temperature, which is the forming temperature. And even to get this data, when you run a test on a rheometer, for instance, you have to still analyze it to even get what the viscosity is at a specific temperature. This is something that requires a computer scientist, a material scientist, an engineer, or a rheologist, or some type of scientist. And that is impractical for a thermoformer or blow motor in a manufacturing company to buy this $150,000 to $1 million instrument, plus hire a scientist on top of it just to analyze the data.
Kind of along the lines where what was going, due to the fact that you can now determine whether or not your raw material is appropriate for manufacturing, are you targeting the right customer? Because if there are a set of characteristics, when these are long runs, so it's not like they're changing and running something different. You start a run like this, you run it for weeks sometimes.
Exactly.
You know you're going to use this plastic to make 1 liter or whatever this is, 20-ounce Pepsi Coke bottles.
Right.
If you send that specification to the supplier and you say, this is what I'm using it for, you know what your tolerance are for that product. They can test that at the supplier and send you a product. And now the benefit is to the supplier because the supplier not to sell you a product at a higher price because you're going to get better yields.
Well, actually, we've contacted the suppliers as well. They don't want the thermoformer or blow motor to be able to test the quality of the material. All of the madness actually happens from the sheet supplier. They are the ones that they get the raw material, they get the pellets, and they actually make the sheets. A lot of times they'll change the dye on you and you'll find out that, you know, you get too much moisture in the material. When they get the edging, they'll throw it back into the main batch, and then that also compromises the quality on a molecular scale. So when we went there, as a matter of fact, they were kind of mad when we were saying that, you know, we went to them and they're like, nah, you know, I don't want anything to do with it. Well, what happened here is that we do a real push on thermoformers. And since thermoformers will now have this, and they'll be able to say, I want an index of blah, blah, blah. I want a viscosity and a modulus of blah, blah, blah. This will force the suppliers to now buy this as well so that they can test themselves before they even ship it out.
Yeah, agree.
Okay. I have a few questions. So we understand that the primary market is thermoformers. And I look at the unit cost of your equipment, which is substantial. Especially against the margins. And so my assumption is, correct me if I'm wrong, that the total addressable market really consists of those thermoformers at $460 million. Is that correct?
Yes, it is.
Okay.
Great question.
So what would keep me from using QA expertise essentially starting a cottage industry, in other words, outsourcing this diagnostic and cutting your total addressable market significantly?
Can I answer that? Well, really, because the QA that is available is actually our team. Our advisor is actually the person. He's a consultant.
Right. But you've created, you know, I'm assuming, you know, when I look at your product, I mean, it's essentially a text fixture, a test fixture, a set of sensors, data reduction and processing algorithm, and a user interface. So you simplified this. So now I'm an independent testing lab, and I buy one of your machines, and I go to the thermoformers and say, look, you don't have to buy a machine for each one of your plants. Have your material drop shipped to me, I'll run the test and ship it to you and lower the size of your total addressable market. So how are you going to guard against the creation of a market of intermediaries, which lowers significantly the size of your total addressable market?
Yeah. We've definitely thought about that, and that's an excellent question, sir. One thing that we were debating is we definitely have some proprietary things with regards to them using our technology and what their capabilities of using it, perhaps primarily in a licensing or such. There's some certain stipulations on how they can use our technology. Or we've often debated with our advisors of whether or not we've become primarily kind of like a credit rating agency, in which we kind of like rate the quality. So we never have to actually give out our proprietary information. So it's a very good point, and we're definitely.
So talk to me a little bit about what those alternative scenarios imply for the business model and the return to the investors.
With regards to that, sir, with having that situation, we think we can still maintain the same margins for the fact that we'll just kind of use it. We'd maintain the same margins because we're able to just charge it on a subscription basis.
Well, help me understand that, because it would seem to me if you're going to become the QA agency and your total addressable model assumes this kind of razor blade model where I have a machine in every thermoformer, and now you're acting and providing a service, the number of units you need to do that to cover the entire industry would be significantly lower. So even at 95% margins, you will on the equipment, wouldn't you experience a significantly lower revenue stream because there would be significantly less units deployed?
I mean, again, if we were to, again, follow that model, that scenario that you're suggesting, we again would have stipulations and we'd be aware if they tried to use it in an adverse way that could affect our bottom line. But again, sir, we have also been doing alternate scenarios in which we could still maintain that same core competence and not even get into that arena by being that agency that would just necessarily just rate the thermoplastic activity coming out and be kind of like how, I guess, like how bonds are rated. And we just rate the bond, rate the plastics.
So I just have one last question. Again, my assumption in looking at your product, it consists of essentially four things. So the test fixture, that's what I clamp the sample into. I have some kind of sensors which are going to capture the physical characteristics of this material when it's in flow. I have some kind of a data reduction and processing algorithm, and I have a user interface. Is that a fair description?
Pretty much.
Of the product? So help me understand what's patentable here.
Okay.
And she actually... she's actually the one getting it patented also.
Okay. So what is patentable is the instrument as a package with the software. The software cannot work without the instrument. Instrument cannot work without the software. So as a package, what we did was streamline the entire system so that everything on it, how it interacts with the PC is through data acquisition and other things. I made sure that, for instance, everything inside it, I could pick up a signal to get it back to PC. So the technology as a whole, as a package, is patentable. But we are also, as we said before, we are also getting advice from our board of advisors dealing with the legal and the licensing.
Okay. So I think about the Xerox machine.
Mm-hmm.
And the critical technology, interestingly enough, on the Xerox machine was the straight through which is why Xerox is no longer a copier company, because smart people figured out if that was the essential critical patent item, they could fix it. Help me understand how you plan to protect your prime mover position.
Again,
because this sounds very generic, at least in conception. So other people, and you can't patent the math. So it's about the algorithm, the processing algorithm, and probably the sensor technology. Help me understand how you're going to protect first mover position against those critical pieces.
Sir, that's an excellent question. And honestly, our position is basically to do an aggressive strategy. That's why we're seeking venture sourcing, because we intend to aggressively attack the market.
5 minutes.
Aggressively attack the market and do capture as much market share as possible, making it fiscally not needable to ascertain our market. It would be comparable to how the Apple strategy, just like before, where there are multiple MP3 players, but due to their robust balance sheet, they're able to aggressively push, make a very interesting value proposition for their core customer, and dominate the making it not economically feasible for their competitor to, you know, attack them. So that's what we hope to do.
Thank you.
And that's why we've established the board of advisors to make sure that could happen.
I know nothing about this technology, but one of the things that struck me is, given that it's targeted to plastic manufacturing, was the impact of the potential impact of the green movement. So as the market demands that more products that are currently made out of plastic be made out of some material that's biodegradable, what impact potentially might that have?
Well, I'm actually working on some of that biodegradable material in my own lab. This is something that we are using this instrument in order to gain more research activity. So, for instance, we have other universities, for instance, who also would be interested in using this as a simple way in order to find greener materials and more sustainable materials. And these are all things that are completely integratable with this instrument, as on a research basis.
Hopefully, you appreciate part of the reason I think people are very focused on the competitive threats that, you know, you're showing us a 95% gross margin product. And so, this broad question is, help us understand how you are able to generate 95% gross margin, because if it's, you know, relatively simple to do it, then everyone and their mother should be out doing the same. So how do you get there? And once we get over that, how do you keep other people from trampling down that same path?
By the way, I have the same question. I've only seen two 95% gross margin businesses, and they were both illegal. So.
That's company. Again, sir, currently, right now, this is what they spend per run, $150,000 to $1 million. Again, we are at $100,000. Again, the reason why we're able to make it.
Who's spending $150 and for what?
Pacton and how we evaluate now is that they run the entire process. That is the process. Or they use a rheometer or an independent lab.
Okay, so I just want to be very clear about what we're talking about. You're telling me that $150,000
depending on
per, I'm not sure what, is the expense of a wasted run for a thermoformer by virtue of, after having done the whole, you know, run, finding out that the material was defective.
Yes, sir.
So you're giving them, you know, $50,000 off to guarantee, and I'm saying, I'm asking the wrong question.